Hello, and welcome to another episode of Starside Chats. We're back. It's now October, and joining me is Aaron Capo.
Hello.
So, you playing any spooky games?
In fact, I am. We'll talk about it a little later, but I have been indulging in some Metroid Dread, which is,
yes,
at times very spooky.
Yeah, I think that'll probably be the main topic of this episode, but we've got a couple other games we've been playing that we should go over. I did throw into our show notes, there was a Nintendo Direct recently that talked about the Animal Crossing 2.0 DLC and the announced pricing model for the expansion pack. It's going to be $50 for a year. And you get, in addition to like Nintendo 64 and Sega Genesis games, you get the Animal Crossing stuff with that for free. No additional cost. Is this something that interests you at all?
My girlfriend is very into Animal Crossing, but we have not visited our island in quite some time. And this seems like a very hefty amount of content for the DLC. So that alone we'll probably be getting. So we already pay for the other Nintendo Online. So the fact that you get the DLC with the Nintendo Online basically right now is a good deal. I don't know if we'll re-up next year, but we'll probably end up getting that and then grabbing that deal. I don't know if we'll play any Nintendo 64 games. I might revisit Ocarina of Time. But yeah, I think we'll be picking this up just probably mainly for the Animal Crossing that you get with it.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think I like the sound of being able to like go onto my Switch and play old Nintendo 64 games, but I don't know if in practice I will actually spend much time doing that. I really want to, but whether I end up making the time for that or not is the big question. But since it is a new month, there are some free games for PlayStation Plus, Xbox Live, and Stadia Pro. Any of these jumping out to you? So I'll say with Stadia Pro, I think they actually have the better lineup for October. So Control Ultimate Edition is on Stadia Pro. Mafia 3, I think that one's one a lot of people were waiting for and asking for, but I've heard it's a little buggy, or at least it was at launch. Hello Engineer, the early access, that's now a Stadia Pro title. Some game called DreamWorks Spirit Lucky's Big Adventure.
What is that?
I have no idea. Cake Bash, which I believe is like a party game. So those are the Stadia Pro titles for October. PlayStation Plus, I think they took some backlash for not having a very good lineup this month, but Hell Let Loose, which my understanding is it's just like a World War II multiplayer shooter.
Okay.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't know.
I have no idea.
Also, PGA Tour, 2K21, and Mortal Kombat 10. Those are your PlayStation Plus titles and the Xbox Live ones. I've not heard of two of these. So Hover and Aero? Question mark? I have no idea.
I don't know.
And then Resident Evil Code Veronica X and Castlevania Harmony of Despair are also free for games with gold. And then there's a bunch of stuff that's come out. Speaking of which, we should maybe just jump right into Metroid. Because that's sort of the big one that I think both of us have been playing.
How far are
you? A fair amount. I have made it to the second area.
What was the last like improved or like power up that you got?
So, I mean, I already have the charge beam. I already have the I took out that one Emmy that gave me the ability to climb on the blue walls.
Yes.
And I defeated the first boss, which gave me the stealth mechanic.
What did you think of that first boss?
It was not as hard as I thought it was going to be. So the game has been relatively difficult to me. And I was expecting to just have to bang my head against the wall in order to figure out the mechanics of that fight for a long time. And I really didn't. Like, I died maybe once, and then I was able to get through it. So, I don't know. What about you?
I did have to bang my head against the wall a little bit, but every time I progressed further, because there's basically three stages in that boss. Like, first you're just shooting it, and then you have to hop up on that wall, and then he becomes invisible. And I died basically at each checkpoint, but I was like, I felt like I was learning it really well. And I basically only had to die those three times. But I really liked it. I thought it was very cool. I'm farther than you. I'm trying to remember how many bosses I've beaten. Maybe like three or four.
Oh, really?
And each time it's in a very similar thing where I get in, I don't really know what I'm doing, and then I figure it out right as I die, and then I do it again, and then I figure out the next stage right as I die. So it's like almost progression within that own boss battle. And I've really been liking it. I have only had to look up things a couple of times. Like, there's been, especially now that a lot more of the map is opened up, I will get something and then I'll be like, well, now what? And so, thankfully, yeah, a lot of people have been asking that same question. So I can just say, like, where to go, like, Google where to go after Grapple is acquired. And it autofills, like, Metroid Dread. And it'll tell you exactly where you have to go. I will say, though, it is beautifully designed. Like, in that first world, basically you're locked out. Every time I've discovered a new teleporter or a new means to get to the next world, I'm always like, well, I wonder if I need to like do more stuff here. And the answer is always no. Like,
yeah.
It's designed so that like once you have found an elevator, that it's time to go in that elevator. Because I just like wandered around in the first area for a long time thinking like, well, is there anything else I can do? And they lock you out based on like abilities, basically. Like, once you're in, there's no going back. And I think that's really cool. Like, I basically, now whenever I see a new teleporter, I just go straight for it. And that's always the right answer, which I think is really cool.
I've almost always found that frustrating, to be honest. Like, I'm like, okay, I finally have this skill that I need to be able to go back and explore this area and get all the things that I want, like all the upgrades and everything. And I'm sure that like wherever I need to go next or whatever I need to find to be able to get through the next area is like back through this area I've already been through. And that always ends up not being the case because like they put up some new wall that you can't get through. Mm-hmm. And so you don't really know what to do. And so I did find it a little bit frustrating because I kind of wanted to explore. And the game's always like, no, you cannot. You must go this other way. Or it's like, you're like, I need to find the thing to get the other thing to get the other thing to be able to get through the next thing. And there's always like another wall preventing you from being able to do that stuff. And so a lot of the time I've been playing, I've felt kind of frustrated by that. Like the boss fight was not frustrating to me at all, but the general attempts at exploration have been.
Now, is this your first Metroidvania-style game? Because it is my first Metroidvania-style game.
I don't know that it's my first Metroidvania-style game. I don't play a lot of them, and usually when I start them, I don't make it terribly far into them. Like, I started Ori, the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And
the Will of the Wisp?
Is that the second one or the first one?
The Blind Forest. Yeah, yeah.
That one I stopped playing more because it was not running right on my computer, so it was more related to that than it was not wanting to play the game. But I was telling you, we were texting about it, and I said once you finish Metroid Dread, you should go onto Stadia and play Grime.
Yeah,
because that's kind of a Metroidvania style game, but also with sort of Dark Souls like combat, which is how they advertise it anyway. I have not really played the Dark Souls game, so I can't really speak to that. I've associate Dark Souls with like frustrating combat where it's like you have to dodge and you have to block and you're more than likely going to take damage and die anyway. But Grime, like, there's similar to Metroid Dread, there's like a counter move where you can like stop incoming
damage.
Parry
system.
Yeah. And the parry system in that game also, like, is you basically have a void on your head and you use that to like parry an enemy who's attacking you. But you also, like, when you do that, if you kill them while you're parrying them, you, like, I guess suck up their life essence and you sort of feed your own, like, health and abilities. So, and you're, like, constantly finding different weapons that have, like maybe you have, like, a fast short sword, or maybe you have, like, a heavy, like, axe or something like that. So there's, like, different play styles you can do with it as well. I don't know.
That's interesting to me.
I really find that game to be very good. I have not played nearly as much of that as I would like, but I also feel like that game is a little bit more straightforward in terms of, like, with Metroid, you're kind of like, I don't know where to go, so I'm just going to explore left, right, up, down, like any possible direction I can go, because the game's not going to tell me where I need to go and I don't know what I'm supposed to do, so I'm just going to like explore for a little while. And with Grime, you pretty much always know you need to be moving from left to right, but you can explore down, and you might even find that you can explore down and left a little bit, but you know ultimately you're always moving to the right. And so I find it a little like they've made it a little bit more clear as to where I'm supposed to go and what I'm supposed to do. And I kind of like that. That's one of the things I find a little bit frustrating about Metroid Dread.
There is a button you can press that makes the map slightly bigger on your screen. And I wish I could just have that on always. But like when you start to move, it shrinks again. Because I am constantly just like pressing the options button to look at the menu and figure out where I am and like what the route I need to go is. I wish almost if there was like a way, I know you can put waypoints, but I wish there was like a thing where you could put a waypoint and then it would guide you through each room with like maybe just like a ribbon of color.
Yeah.
I feel like that would be a great feature to have. Because then it doesn't take me out of the action because I'm constantly checking like, okay, do I need to go up in this room or down in this room to get around this obstacle I can't unlock yet to get to the next part?
Yeah, it would be like in Dead Space where like you hit a button and there's like a little line that goes out, and that would be a good way to prevent you from always having to like stop and open your map and look around. You just more free flowing move throughout the map. I would like
that.
I'm not
advocating for like an objective. Like I know people like that it's not really handholdy. I'm saying like you are the one putting down the marker and then it pathfinds for you.
Right.
Like it's not going to tell you like, well, now you have to go to this area. Like I'm not saying that. I'm just saying it would be great if I didn't have to plan my route as much that takes me out of the action.
I'm saying for me personally, I wish there was almost a little bit more handholding. Like if I play a game where and this was a little bit the case with one of your favorite games, Hyper Light Drifter, where it was like, ooh, I like this game, I like the art style, I like the music, I like the action, but I get frustrated because I don't know where I'm supposed to go or what I'm supposed to do. Mm. And so I will wander aimlessly for like a half an hour before I find the one thing that I missed that like unlocks the next area for me to be able to go. And I was like, I find that a little bit frustrating. Like, I don't love feeling like I'm wasting my time not knowing where to go or what to do. And it's made a little bit worse with Metroid Dread, where you go into a certain area and there's like an unkillable enemy chasing you. So now you can't even like be thoughtful about like where you want to explore. You basically just run and you end up going wherever that takes you. And it may or may not be the right way. So, to an extent, that reminds me a lot of Resident Evil 7 and Resident Evil Village, because those games, you're basically being chased most of the time. Like, there are some safe rooms, but like you're mostly being chased by an enemy and you're just hoping to find the right direction or like sort of kite the enemy one way and then evade them and go around the next way. But I don't want to sound like I'm coming down too hard on Metroid Dread, because I do like it. I am enjoying, I love the art style. I like how sort of mysterious it is. I like the vibe of it. And I do think the action and combat is cool, but I don't know that Metroidvanias are necessarily my genre.
Yeah.
But I know this is, I think it is more up your alley than it is mine, because you kind of like a game that's pretty vague and not handholdy, and you don't mind like having to explore for a half an hour before you finally figure out the one thing you need to get to the next area.
I'm into that. Yeah, like it is good to liken it to Hyper Light Drifter, because I do get that vibe. It's not to skip ahead, but something I kind of don't enjoy about Eastward is whenever you get a power-up or an upgrade, it's finite, which is not something I'm into. Like, in Hyper Light Drifter or in Metroid Dread, when you get a new thing, like when you get a new sword attack in Hyper Light Drifter, or when you get, like, a new ability in Metroid Dread, it's never locked. Like, it's not... The only thing you have ammo for is your missiles or whatever. Like, when you get the grapple beam, you just have the grapple beam. And, like, in Hyper Light Drifter, when you get, like, more dashes, you just have more dashes. Whereas in Eastward, if I got a new gun, I'm constantly having to look for ammo, and I'm constantly running out of ammo. And if I got a new bomb that I have to use for puzzles, I better learn that puzzle fast, because if I don't, I'm going to be out of bombs, and I have to go all the way back to get more bombs. And so I am a sucker for games similar to the old God of War games, where, like, you're constantly getting new weapons that give you new abilities, and they're not... You just have those abilities now. It's a good, like, it's that power fantasy where you're constantly getting stronger. It's not like, well, you've got this new gun, now start looking for this new type of ammo. Because if you don't have that ammo, there are going to be parts of the game where we're just not going to give you that ammo, so you don't have this as an option. You're always going to have these options you're getting in Metroid Dread to solve puzzles, which I really like.
Yeah, but to an extent, I find Metroid Dread's like, okay, well, you found this new thing, and that's cool and all, but we've just put a new barrier in your way, so you can't get back to where you wanted to go to actually use it.
That's very true.
And so I find that frustrating, but it does, like, obviously enable you to make it through a different way. It's just not the way you thought it was going to be, mm-hmm. and so maybe I just need to adjust my headspace for that, but, like... I don't know. As somebody who likes to be able to more freely explore, just constantly running into walls everywhere of you can't go here yet. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I find that a little bit irritating, but otherwise I'm enjoying it.
I didn't watch any trailers, or I watched very brief trailers for this, but the first time, like very early on in the game, when you encounter the first robot, unkillable robot, and you get the, gun that you get that destroys them. Mm-hmm. I did not expect it to like change perspectives the way that it does when you aim it. And I thought that was a really cool design choice. Especially later on, there is a robot that is super fast, like faster than all the rest of them. And like when you have to look at it and charge up and stuff, and it goes like there's like a long hallway and it's coming at you. It's pretty intense. I really enjoy that. It kind of mixes it. That also happens when you parry things. Like, it'll zoom in, kind of, which I think is really... It's a really cool artistic choice.
Yeah, and there are... It seems like some of the cutscenes in the game do shift to first person, and that's almost like a... Hey, this is what it's going to be like when Metroid Prime 4 comes out. It's almost like a tease ahead to that game that may or may not ever come out.
Do you think that... Oh, speaking of Hyper Light Drifter, that Solar Ash game got delayed to December.
Oh, did it?
But do you think that Metroid Prime 4 will come out on the current iteration of the Switch? Or do you think it'll be like a Switch 2 game? What if this happens, Zach? What if... They announced the Switch 2, whatever it's going to be called, and they're like, launch titles are Breath of the Wild 2, Metroid Prime 4. Like, everyone in the world would buy that.
Yeah, for sure. I do think, from what I've heard, and maybe this is just rumor, not confirmed, but they launched the Switch OLED because they were planning a Switch Pro. And it was going to have the OLED screen and everything, but it was also going to have a dock that could output 4K. Mm. And then, because that was the rumor that I think Bloomberg had like a leak on it that they wrote an article about.
Right before E3, I remember that.
Yeah, and so they, like, after the announcement of the Switch OLED, everybody was like, that's not a Switch Pro. Like, you were wrong, Bloomberg. And, Jason Schreier, who's, like, one of the big, like, video game writers that writes for Bloomberg, was saying, well, we stand by our reporting. So, which told me that more than likely there was at some point a Switch Pro model that had a dock that could output in 4K.
Mm-hmm.
And most likely because of the chip shortage, they were like, well, we have all these, like, the screens are not a problem. We can ship those. Why not just, like, do an update or an upgrade to the base model Switch and just start doing the Switch OLED and people can get that. And then maybe in like a year or two when the chip shortage situation is less of an issue, we can actually launch the Switch Pro. So I don't think you're that far off, actually, that they could launch Breath of the Wild 2 and Metroid Prime 4, or if not, if Breath of the Wild 2 ends up coming out next year and they're still not ready for it, maybe the year after that or something.
Yeah, I don't know. They started Metroid Prime 4 basically from scratch. Like, they famously were like, well, this is not really working out, so we're just going to go back to zero. So who knows how far along it's, like, they've changed directions significantly.
Right.
I think they even changed developers. But I don't know. That'll be very interesting to see. Especially if they do, is this a good idea? If they did a thing where, since it is first person, what if they did a thing where you held the Switch out in front of you and then turning in real life the game? Would that be cool or bad?
I think that would be bad. Because it would be, you would run into stuff.
Well, no, you wouldn't be going forward or backward. You would only be standing in one spot and, like, turning around. But, yeah, it probably would be bad.
Maybe if that was, like, an option that you could turn off, or if it was, like, only for specific parts of the game and not the entire game.
Yeah, because then you couldn't play it on a TV.
Yeah, you wouldn't be able to play it on a TV, but also, like, even if you were just, like, sitting on your couch, like, imagine trying to contort yourself so that you could see the thing that you need to see.
Or turn around, like, 365, yeah. Like, 360 degrees.
I don't think that would work out too well. So that's probably not going to be a feature. Although they did that with Pokemon Let's Go, where if you're not using the Joy-Cons, but you had, like, the Switch in portable mode and you had the Joy-Cons attached to the console, when you went to go catch a Pokemon, you would literally look around in order to aim at it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you would move the Switch around to find the Pokemon, and then you would hit a button to throw the Pokeball.
Oh, I do remember that, actually, yeah.
So they've done that before, just as, like, one element of the game and not all of the game, but also it was just an option. Like, you didn't have to play it that way.
Do you think we'll ever get a Metroid Prime movie or a Metroid movie?
I was thinking about that. I think it would be cool because, like I said, I do like the art style and I like how mysterious it is. And I kind of,
the story's interesting.
It is, like, I want to know more about the lore. And, like, I want to know, like, what the Chozos are and all of that stuff. Like, I don't have much of a history with this franchise, so there's a lot I don't know about it.
Yeah, there is a part coming up for you, probably in a couple of hours, where there's a big exposition scene, and I was just, like, completely, not lost, but I was just like, wow, well, there's a lot of stuff being thrown at me that I kind of understand, but this is, like, a dense information scene.
Yeah, well,
I'll be interested to see when you get there.
There was a cutscene at the very beginning of the game as well that was sort of like a, here's your refresher on Metroid history.
Yeah,
that kind of went through, like, the events of some of the past games, but it was very, like, short. So it was like,
yeah,
but it was cool to see that. And so I imagine there's probably more of that. But I should almost look up more of a detailed, like, lore and history and, like, the direction.
I thought about doing that, but then I realized, like, maybe I want to play these old Metroid games because I'm having a good time with this one. And I have heard from multiple sources that Super Metroid is an example of a perfect video game.
Yeah, there's a lot of love out there for Super Metroid. I have started that game a couple of times, but never made it very far.
Really? What was bad about it? Or like, what just stopped your progress?
Either I just moved on to other things, or I got lost somewhere and didn't know what to do next.
Yeah.
But that, I mean, that's on, if you've got Switch Online, so you can play that on your Switch right now.
It's true.
So there is that. Yeah, I want to play more of the game, but other games that have been out have sort of prevented me from doing that. Maybe that's a natural segue into some other games we've been playing. You talked a bit about Eastward. Maybe we should jump into Eastward, because I have started Eastward, but I'm not very far.
I think that Eastward has a very strong opening. Like, the first 3 hours, like 3 or 4 hours of Eastward, are super solid. Like, there's interesting story. You're like, oh, why are these people underground? What's really going on? You don't really get full control of both characters at once for a good amount of time.
So I don't have full control of both characters. I just have one character right now.
When you do, it gets pretty cool. Like, there are some cool puzzles where you do, where like one person is on one side of a barrier and the other person's on another side. And even though that's been done 1,000 times, they make it interesting. The art style is great. The music is great. The dialogue is not super good. And I would say the story is... I don't understand the story. I've actually reached a point where I really don't understand the story. I don't remember whose review it was, but I was reading some review of it where the guy was like, it's a very like verbose game. It uses two sentences when one sentence would do, and one sentence when no sentences would do. It's very much a tell, don't show game. I don't know if it would be as annoying if it was voice acted. That I think that would also take away from what it's trying to go for with its like 16-bit aesthetic. But the fact that there are so many scenes where I just have to click continue every 5 seconds because people are talking, and it's not skippable, and it's just like sprites like walk around a little bit and then have another bit of dialogue, it's very frustrating to me.
I didn't check, but is there an option in the menu to like have it auto scroll through text instead of having you like have to hit the button to advance to the next bit of text?
I don't know. Sometimes people will, like, a character will be very excited or, like, for comedic effect, will talk very quickly. In those instances, you can't stop the text. Like, it just starts auto-scrolling for you because it's meant to be like, oh, they're talking so fast you can't keep up.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't hold your hand super well, which I need a little bit of hand-holding. Like, I just got to the final, what I believe to be the final town. And I just now realized that with the right analog stick, you can swap between weapons without having to like hold a button down and go to a menu, which would have been helpful to know very early on in the game. And I don't think they ever tell you. Maybe they do and I just missed it. But I don't super enjoy all of the dialogue, I have to say. Especially in the third town you get to. Man, a lot of that is just like random side quests that I do not care about and are meant to be like super comedic but just fall flat. The comedy in the game is not great to me, but I really don't know how I feel about it yet. Like, I wish that it was more like a Hyper Light Drifter where when I got new items, I could be excited about them and it gave me like new traversal methods and like new ways to kill enemies. But really, it is just like you have one weapon that you can whack people with a frying pan, and then you can... like shoot them with a gun and then you get some other things, but it all is just like, oh, well, you only have like 15 bullets, so you really gotta make this count. And health also, I wish there was an easier way to refill it. You do eventually get a power that lets you slowly refill your health, but that's also gated because you like the currency that you get to like power up that power is like very hard to come by, so you're only able to do it every so often. It doesn't just like auto refill over time. So I'm in a situation right now where I've spent a long time to get to a thing that is optional, but it's a boss fight you have to get to, and I'm deep in this cave, and I only have like 4 hearts, and I have not done a lot of cooking or like purchased a lot of stuff, so I can't refill those hearts unless I go way far back to a point where I might not even be able to get back to, or else it'll progress the story and I won't be able to come back here. And so I either have to beat this boss with like 5 hearts or just not get this optional item, which is a real bummer. And that happened to me in the other town as well. I got to a place and I wasn't really sure how to beat this puzzle and I didn't want to look it up. And so I just kept progressing because I thought, like, well, maybe I get something else that'll help me. And eventually I progressed to the point where I couldn't go back and get the thing. Thankfully, it was not a super necessary thing. Although I say that it probably would help me out in this instance I'm in right now. But I don't know. This game is close to being something that I think is really great. But I think there are some things that really fall flat for me design-wise as well as like story dialogue-wise that is really pushing it down to like a high C for me almost, maybe a low B.
Really? Yeah, I again, I've only barely started it, so I'm not very far into it, but like the art style and music is great, like you said, and I do, like, already I can tell, like, they just, it's a lot of dialogue that you're clicking yes. through, and a lot of the it time I'm just like, I just want to get to the next, like, story beat, and I'm still here just, like, clicking through dialogue, and I wish that there was a little bit more action to it.
I will say, I think it's worth playing up until the third town you get to. And at that point, if it's not hooked you already, then I can think you can stop and just say you're done. But okay. I think that there is enough going on where when you get to the third town, you will want to continue. You just have to make it to that to see if you actually want to continue.
Okay. Yeah, well, and it's one of those games that has kind of fallen on the back burner for me just because there's so many other games to play right now. And, like, again, I like the art style and music, and I want to like the game, but it has not hooked me yet. So it has sort of fallen on the back burner a little bit.
It's so much, there's so much potential. Like, you, when you're playing as the girl, she basically only has one power, and you can get some other powers. Again, those are completely optional, and you could miss them. But I feel like the combat could be so much more interesting and like satisfying, as opposed to it just being like, well, you can whack things, and if you hold it down, you can whack in like an arc kind of, and if you're the girl, you can shoot a thing that freezes things for a second. I feel like there's so much more you could have done, but instead of focusing on gameplay aspects, they focused on story, which I feel is the wrong call because they were not super good at that.
Yeah, I can see why you would say that, even in just like the much smaller amount that I have played compared to you, but
I don't know. I jury's still out. I am at the point where I believe there are no towns left, so I'm reaching the end. But
how much time are you in on it?
18 hours, maybe.
I'm not sure how long it is. I've heard it's like roughly 30 hours.
That's insane to me. Because unless something drastic happens in this, I believe I'm at the last town, and I think I am around 15 or 18 hours, but who knows? Maybe I have just missed a bunch, but
yeah, you know, right, and maybe
I will have a full review.
Okay, oh, and maybe that's some of that is just like people exploring a little bit more and trying to like check off every item.
I'm going to keep, the thing is there's not a ton of items as far as I can tell, but I'll keep playing it, and when I finish it, I'll have like my full review, but right before we started recording, you dropped a bombshell on me, Zach.
Yes. So I have started playing New World, and
the new MMO.
It is a new MMO. It's, I don't know about you, but when I went to Twitch, like everybody that I was following was playing it there for like a week, just watching a bunch of it got me kind of interested in playing it. And I was like, well, it's $40, and I know I will get $40 worth of game out of this, regardless of if I stick with it or not. And lo and behold, it has sort of like eaten up all of my like free time, my game time. It's the game that I keep going back to because I can't seem to get enough of it. But we were talking before we started recording, and I was saying it is the perfect podcast game because it's the game that you can put on a podcast or a TV show or something in the background and just like run around mining or like chopping down trees or like doing some crafting and working on just like leveling up some of your other skills in the game. And all of that stuff is very, very satisfying. Like, I know there are some people that are like, well, the combat's maybe not as deep as some other MMOs, but I actually like it. I kind of like that it's more of a, like a third person action game where you only have like three abilities tied to like Q, R, and F. And then you have like your hack and slash and your block and your dodge. And so things are a little bit more simple in that regard, but there's also like a good amount of flexibility in terms of like how you want to approach combat, because there are different weapons. I should say it's it's not like Skyrim or what's another good example, like Mass Effect, where you're like picking a class and you're like, this is the class I'm going to play. You're, it's a little bit more like Monster Hunter, where your class is tied to the weapons you choose to use. And then as you're leveling up, you're going to put your skill points into attributes that feed into whatever weapons you've chosen. And so for me, like, I'm going for more of like a paladin build. So like I'm kind of building a tanky like sword and shield guy whose second weapon is a life staff. So I can like throw down like these little healing areas, and like each weapon has sort of two skill trees, and you're not forced into like one of them. You can kind of pick some abilities and some passives from both trees. And so the life staff has like a protection tree and like a healing tree, and they both offer some healing. So even if you just throw down like a protection area, you get some healing from that. So if you like throw down a protection area and then a healing area on top of it, and then with my tanky sword and shield guy run into that and just kind of stand in it and start taking down enemies, it ends up being very good for solo play. But also it's like a really good sort of group play thing as well for like dungeons and stuff.
Yeah, I've heard it's, so you were also telling me something interesting before we started about how there's like a weird thing going on in game with like the company system.
Yeah, so that's like how they do guilds. So you, at some point you join a faction. There are three factions. And I don't know a lot about the lore about the different factions, but I sort of chose one, the green one, which is the Marauders. And they sort of sounded more like a militaristic, almost like a future war cult in Destiny. And I was like, well,
oh yeah,
well, I'm playing, you know, sort of a tanky, like sword and shield, like soldier type of a character. So maybe if I'm role playing him, maybe he would be interested in something like the Marauders. And so that's what I went with. That was the only thing I went off of. I don't know anything about like the different groups or which ones you should choose. But there's another faction that is, I forget the name of it, but it's more, it seems more like a mage's guild type of thing. They're sort of almost like religious fanatics, which did not sound appealing to me, so I did not choose that one. And then there's a third faction that's a little bit more about like secrecy and intelligence and sort of the rogue class, if you were to turn the factions into actual classes.
That's something that speaks to me.
Yeah, and I was going to say, I think that one is the most populous of the three factions. It's definitely the one that seems to be doing the most on the server that I'm on. But so you pick a faction, and then within that faction, you can join a company, which is the equivalent of guilds. And so one of the things that is happening that people are noticing is that the companies, the system is being maybe a little bit abused, where, and maybe it's just like a thing that the developers knew would happen or could happen, and they're fine with it because it is sort of like it's a thing that could happen in real life, or it's like a strategy that you could use if you were like feeding into sort of the lore of the game, and like, you've got this one faction that's all about like secrecy and intelligence. Like, I could see this happening. But so basically you will have somebody start a company, and they're then, and if they buy like a region, they'll be like the governor of that region. And so they're sort of the owner of the company, and they will recruit a bunch of people. They'll add them to the guild, and they'll ask people for donations to the treasury, because you can use the money in the treasury to like buy a settlement, buy a region in the game. And then there are wars where different companies will fight it out over those regions. So there's sort of like territory conquest type of a situation going on. I have not been able to partake in that because I'm not high enough level yet, but like that's one of the things that happens in the game. And so people are noticing that a leader of a company will either be, it's one of two things. They are either really like selfish and petty, and if they lose a war, they will get angry at everyone for not winning. And so they will steal all the gold from the treasury and disband the company and defect to a different faction and join a different company and just have all of the money for that. Or they are doing it on purpose because it's like a second character and they've planned it from the beginning. They're going to get everybody to donate to the treasury and then just steal everything and leave. And so one person started a Reddit thread talking about how that happened in their server. And then like everybody, there was just like floods of messages after that of everybody else being like, yeah, you, we saw this too. This happened to us as well. And it happened to me. So the first company I joined, it was very random. I had just joined a faction. I was still really early on. And they were like, hey, join our company. I was like, okay. I mean, why not? Probably better to be a part of one than not. And so I joined it, and it seemed like the leader of the company was just on 24/7. Because every time I logged on, they were on, and they were asking for donations to the treasury. And then like a week...
Did you donate at all?
Not much. I didn't have much money to begin with, because I was still so early on. So like maybe 200 gold, like not much. But I was also afraid that they were going to kick me for not like participating. So I was like, I'll give you something and you can just like be happy with that. And then like a week later, I logged in and like opened up the guild menu and noticed that I was like not in a guild anymore. It was acting like I needed to join one. I was like, what's going on here? And so I just assumed that it was because I was like too low level, I wasn't contributing enough, I wasn't playing the game enough, I wasn't participating, and they were like wanting to do wars and stuff, and so maybe they were booting some of the lower level players for higher level players. I was like, whatever, that makes sense, I get it. I'm not happy about it, but I understand it. And then later, people in the faction started typing in the chat that like that company was just gone. It was like off the server. And I was like, oh, what happened here? Because I didn't actually look at what guilds were still in the game. Like I didn't notice that that one was just completely gone. And so one of the players was like explaining it that they weren't sure exactly how it went down, but it was one of those situations where either the leader of the company was very petty after a loss in war, and so they just took all the money and disbanded the group. They even deleted the Discord. There was like a Discord server for that company.
Scorched earth.
Yeah, or they had planned this from the beginning and this was the second character and they were just doing it to screw over one of the other factions. And so like
it's crazy that they allow you to do this.
Yeah, and so we're not sure. I saw an article written about it because they were responding to the Reddit thread about it. And they were saying they were not sure if this is the kind of thing that the developers knew could happen and are okay with it, or if this is like an abuse of the system and it's like bad for the player experience and that they'll eventually take steps to try to stop it. But I don't know how I feel about it. I've been kind of back and forth. I was like, it is a bad experience. Like, because it happened to me, I have personal experience with it. So, I get it. I see why it's not a good experience. But also, like, it could happen. Like, in real life, that could happen. But also, like, if you're sort of buying into the lore, like, you would bet that one faction that's all about secrecy and intelligence, like, they probably would do something like that. So, like, part of me is like, that I can't be mad at it. It's strategy.
It's good role playing.
Yeah, good role playing. It's good strategy. I get it. Like, but the other side of me is like, yeah, but maybe also it sucks a little bit. So
it does suck a little bit because if it was a real world, like, you couldn't just do a thing where you would clone yourself and then when you're done, that other person just gives you all the money and phases out of existence.
Yeah.
But also, like, I get it. I mean, I don't know if I'm... I always used to love reading about those crazy political intrigues that would happen in EVE Online where, like, someone would get burned and then spend, like, 18 months getting into another guild, like, under another name just to, like, get, like, I don't even know, acquire some sort of power in that guild and then betray everyone and have, like, a huge battle take place. But I don't know. I don't know if I would enjoy actually playing that.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's more fun to read about than it is to necessarily be involved in it, but...
Yeah.
But I'll say it's interesting, and I think it is one of the things that makes New World a little bit more intriguing, for good or for bad.
Yeah.
But I like a lot of everything else that New World's doing. Like, I will say, I think it's a good-looking game as well. Like,
Oh, it is, yeah, for sure.
The environments are very, like... lush with like foliage and stuff, because the other MMO I've played a decent amount of is ESO, and I'll say ESO is significantly better in terms of like questing. And we were talking before the show about how I think questing in ESO is much better, and maybe some of that is just because it's been around longer. But also, like, the storytelling is just better, and, like, there's dialogue options, and you feel like you're having a lot of conversations, and, like, it's doing a pretty good job of telling, like, little stories within the world or the location that you happen to be at the time. And so ESO, you could probably play it, like, as a solo player and just play through all the story content and feel like you're getting... like a pretty good Elder Scrolls game, even as just a solo player, if you don't want to engage with like PvP and like dungeons and doing a lot of like the in-game PvE stuff. So New World is definitely not on par with that in terms of its questing. They're much more bland, like MMO style quests, but that doesn't mean that they might not get there eventually. I don't know what the long tail of the game is. I don't know what the roadmap is. I don't know that they've released one or even talked about it. So, like, there are plenty of people who are just, like, grinding until they get to max level. And they're, like, here in a week or two, if not already, they're going to be like, well, there's not enough end game here. So, like, I'm done until they add something else. But there is... so much to do in the game already that for someone like me who's going to play it more casually and doesn't have like an entire week of free time to grind away at the game, it's going to take me a long time to get to max level. So for sure, I think you can get your money's worth out of it. The question will be how aggressive the developers are going to be in terms of like providing events and additional content post-release.
It'll be interesting to see, because I've noticed that as well, where I follow a couple of people on Twitch, and some of them have fallen off of this already, that were playing it, like, nonstop. And a lot of it, I mean, some of it is because, like, the people I watch are doing, like, other branded content that they want to, that they've gotten contracted to do, but I'll be interested to see, like, what the tale is on this, and if they do have some stuff planned.
Yeah, I've watched a lot of Shroud play the game, and... like, I think initially he was doing it because he was being sponsored to. Like, they had for a while there where, like, they do the Twitch drops where you can get, like, in-game cosmetics and stuff from watching Twitch streamers stream the game. And, I mean, that led to some headaches, I think, for some Twitch streamers because it was like, well, there's, like, three... streamers who have drops enabled and the rest of us are just kind of out of luck because who's going to watch them stream the game when they can get drops from these other people. But so I don't know if maybe some of those people were only streaming it because they were being sponsored to stream it, but like the drops are over now and Shroud is still playing on a pretty regular basis. So I think some people are more into it than others. I know there were some people that were not super happy with like the combat. They think it's kind of bland. I enjoy it. I like how it feels a little bit more weighty. And like we were talking about how we don't think MMO combat is very good or interesting. But I think this feels quite a bit better than combat I've experienced in other MMOs.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I'm into it. I've been playing a lot of it, and it like, even if you're just like the type of person that likes like hunting and gathering, like I feel like, what is that game, Valheim, where basically the entire game is running around like hunting and gathering and crafting. Like there's a whole game worth of that within New World, even before you start thinking about, you know, going around and getting into combat, doing dungeons, and playing any of the other content in the game. So there's that as well. But playing New World has prevented me from playing a lot of other games, just because it has sucked me in a way I maybe didn't even expect. But
well, and you sent me a snap of loading into the beta for Battlefield 2042, and I'm interested to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I've played maybe an hour or two of the beta, and I think it was up only for the weekend, last weekend. It felt like more Battlefield to me, in a good way, but also like I think there were people that were complaining that like it was a little buggy. I mean, it's a beta, you kind of expect that, but I did think there was like cool new abilities. I don't know why all of these games, including like Battlefield and Call of Duty, are going more to these like heroes within the game, where like
operators.
Yeah, operators, where you're playing like a named character with a specific face as opposed to like a generic soldier. And so there are four different sort of operators, and they each have a different piece of equipment that's unique to them. But you can also sort of switch up the rest of your loadout. So it feels like maybe the most flexible that the class system has been in Battlefield for quite some time, at least to me. So like if you want to play kind of a healer who can, you know, throw out the little health boxes or whatever, you can do that and still, you know, carry an assault rifle or an LMG or a sniper rifle if you want. And you can do that while still using the one operator's like grappling hook ability. Or if you want to swap out the grappling hook, you can use I think one of the other characters has like some sort of drone. So you can sort of swap in and out all these different things. And so I really like that about it. Whereas in like a past Battlefield, if you wanted to play the healer, you were tied to assault rifles and that kit. And then so you couldn't carry anything like any sort of explosive if you wanted to try to also take on a tank. You're just kind of out of luck. So I do like the flexibility it offers there. And I like the grappling hook is very cool. I don't think it's as good as the one from Halo.
Apex? Oh, yeah, Halo.
Which I think maybe you have some thoughts on. I have not. I didn't play that.
I didn't hop on. I'm not a Halo insider or whatever, but Microsoft Insider, whatever it is. But I watched a good amount of that beta take place, and unlike Battlefield, they are basically leveling the playing field, where there are no loadouts, there's no operators, you're just a Spartan, and it's like it's very much old school Halo, which I'm pretty excited about. I never picked up that Master Chief Collection, but the fact that this is going to be free, the multiplayer at least, and it looks so solid, like, I watched hours of it, just people playing it, and, like, a lot of the people were saying, like, man, this feels like Halo 2 or, like, Halo 1 style combat. Like, I could play this forever. I'm into that. I like that there are the new, they've been conservative, but they've added things that are pretty interesting. Like there's a new grenade type that does like a slow area of effect, like damage over time, which is interesting and disables vehicles. And they did, like you said, they added the grappling hook, and there are obviously some new weapons and stuff. But I'm super into this. I thought I was going to play way more of that Splitgate, but I ended up being a little frustrated by the portals to the point where I was just like, I think I just want Halo. And I think when this comes out, the fact that, like, unlike Destiny, something I never super got into Destiny was the multiplayer aspect, because, I mean, you would drop into some PvP and someone would just, like, have a Vex Mythoclast and you could hear it across the map and be like, well, I got to avoid that guy because I just have, like, these blue guns that I just acquired. But everybody has the same guns. I don't even know if you can start. There's probably custom games where you can start with specific guns, but the guns are on the map. You have to search them out. And, like, power weapons only spawn every so often. And so...
Yeah, that's very old school.
Yeah, PvP. It's like, it's a reason why I love, I still love PUBG, where, like, you know, it's a, you drop and then you just get weapons and everybody's on the same level playing field. And I'm actually pretty excited for, I think I'll probably get it on PC because obviously I don't have an Xbox, but I'm pretty excited to jump in whenever the free multiplayer comes out for Halo. And you should as well. We should maybe do a video on it.
We should. Yeah, I do want to download it.
It's a multiplayer
experience.
Yeah. It's a multiplayer experience that I think I'm going to be really into. And it will be very much replayable.
Yeah, I saw a video of a guy like running around one of the maps and just using the grappling hook to like swing around like Spider-Man. I was like, yeah. Wow, this is crazy. Like, I don't think you'd be able to do that in Battlefield, but in Halo, like if you're good enough, you could swing around the entire map using the grappling hook and just like land on people with a melee or something.
It looks super fun. I'm pretty pumped that they decided to make it free. I am worried that it's going to be like 100 gigs, but it's not like I don't have the space for it, but it is like a little bit of an inconvenience, especially if like it does some kind of nonsense where it downloads the whole Halo campaign.
I was
going to
say,
just, like,
I think that's what's going to happen.
That's terrible to me.
Like, I hope it doesn't, but I would almost bet that if you download the Halo Infinite multiplayer, you're downloading the whole package. And then you just pay to unlock the campaign part.
That's awful. Because I wish it would be like 30 gigs. But again, it's not like I have an abundance of space on my computer. So it's nothing for me to complain about. But it's just going to take a while to download. It's not like it's on Stadia where I can just like load it up and play it immediately.
Yeah. Yeah. That's been an issue with Destiny 2 for me, because I did re-download it and I'm playing it on PC again. Yeah. After we said that we would probably, if we were to get back into the game, we would do it on Stadia. But I like the higher frame rate that I can get and the more consistent visual experience I get with the PC version. So
yeah.
And speaking of Destiny 2, they do have a Halloween event happening, and I jumped in one night this week after reset and started playing some of that, and it's fun. They actually have, so they've decked out the tower in like Halloween aesthetic, and then there's like a playlist that you can join that's a little like the strike playlist, but instead of strikes, it's redone versions of Lost Sectors. And
oh, interesting.
And the enemies you're fighting are Hive, that are like the Headless Horsemen, where they have like a pumpkin for the head. And so it's like, it's really goofy fun, and there's a pretty good pulse rifle that you can get from playing it. So, and they're dropping quite a bit, so if you want to really pursue that and try to get like a good roll on it, mm-hmm. you just play a lot of that. And there's like, it's very grindy if you want to get like, I think the ultimate prize, which is an exotic sparrow that looks pretty cool. So, but you, in order to get it, you have to like buy like 6 or 7 Halloween masks.
Oh, really?
And in order to get those, you have to grind just a ton of content for candy that drops, and then you spend the candy like a currency to buy the masks. And I have bought one of them so far, and like it's not like a cumulative thing where you keep getting more candy, and then you eventually are able to buy all of them. Like, once you've bought one, that takes your candy down to zero, and you have to go back out and collect a lot more. So it's very, very grindy, but I did enjoy running those lost sectors and taking out the hive bosses. So so I recommend it if you're getting back into Destiny 2. I will say also, I found that it seems like supercharged, like powerful weapon drops as well. I felt like I was constantly getting something that was like pushing my character level higher.
Interesting.
In a way that I haven't seen since I hit the soft cap. So maybe it's just me. Maybe it was just because it was like a new week, and so you expect to get more powerful drops after reset, because like every activity, if you play it like three times or whatever, you get like another powerful drop. But yeah. I don't know, I felt like I was getting a bunch of powerful drops. So what else have you been playing?
Pretty much only Eastward and Metroid Dread. I'll get to a point in one of those games where I hit a roadblock and I'll just swap to the other one for a while. But I did want to mention in the what we're playing / watching segment, I rewatched Mission Impossible 3 just randomly this Tuesday, and it's like such a good movie.
Yeah. I feel like,
have you ever seen it?
I feel like my family does like a rewatch of the Mission Impossible movies like every
holiday season.
They're
so good. They're so watchable. Yeah. It's like every one of them, it's like that and Fast and Furious are really good at heightening the action. Every one you like. So like 4 is better than, not necessarily better, but like crazy stuff happens in each of them. And it's different enough where like all of them have such iconic scenes. I think I've only ever seen the latest one with Henry Cavill in theaters. So I might try to just like keep rewatching them and get to that one again.
That one's so good. It might be the best one.
It might be, yeah. It's
or the one.
It's so good.
What one was the one before that?
Rogue Nation.
There's Fallout and there's Rogue Nation and something, I don't know.
Ghost Protocol.
But the ones with Rebecca Ferguson, is that her name?
Yes.
Those two are excellent. And
yes, I agree.
Very rewatchable. It's like they really found a new stride once they added her to the mix.
I'm excited for the new one whenever it comes out. I think they're done filming it. But yeah, Mission Impossible is a great series, and it's just like so nice. I just for some reason I think I got to a point in both Eastward and Metroid Dread where I was like, I don't want to deal with this right now. And so I was just like, you know what, I could watch a movie. And then it just so happened there was like a deal, and I rented Mission Impossible 3 for like $1 or like 99 cents on Google Play, and it was a great evening.
Nice. Yeah, every time I hit a roadblock in Metroid Dread again, I just jump back into New World and get lost for a long period of time. But there is one other game that I've been playing recently.
Oh, really?
It's called Rogue Lords.
You have talked about this to me a little bit, yeah.
So it's a little bit like Slay the Spire, except it's not card-based. It's just a turn-based RPG.
Okay.
That's also a roguelike. And so you're running around this map, and you're going, and you have like branching pathways, and like one direction will take you to an event where there's a little bit of like story that you're getting. And depending on how you navigate that, you may get like some bonuses or some upgrades for one of your characters. And you have 3 characters, and all the characters are like different monsters from like legendary monsters like Dracula and the Headless Horseman, and you know, characters like that. Like, I think I haven't unlocked them yet, but I think at some point you get Dr. Frankenstein. So it's characters like that. And they've set it up where they sort of each have sort of fulfill a different role. Like the Headless Horseman is sort of your tank, and Dracula's kind of your healer, because he can inflict vampirism on your other characters so that when they attack, they regain health. and Bloody Mary is the third character that you start out with, and she throws a mirror behind somebody, and every time she attacks, it does like a double attack. So she's like kind of your attacker. So she deals like a lot of damage. And I like the art style. I like it. It's kind of, in some ways, it's a little like Hades, where it's a roguelike. And so as you go, you're getting these different upgrades. And so you're kind of like, well, this run feels like it's not going to go that far because I'm not getting the right drops. And in some ways, it's like, it's like Star Renegades a little bit, where like it's got a pretty good like turn-based combat system, and you're just sort of navigating the map and choosing your path and sort of picking which battles you want to take on and which ones you want to try to avoid. And I don't know, I'm really liking it. I've cleared like the first, I think there are like six artifacts, and each of them are tied to like a different campaign, sort of. So you're navigating the map, and there are a bunch of different unlockable characters. And so, like I said, I'm only on like the second artifact, so I've completed the first one, and I think the ultimate goal is to take down Van Helsing, who's like, I think, the main bad guy behind it. But it's interesting thing about it is that you're sort of playing the devil, and so you have you have devil mode, and so like Dracula and the Headless Horseman and Bloody Mary are your what is the term they use? I forget. They're your minions, basically, and so you're kind of controlling them throughout it, and you can enter devil mode at any time in combat, or even like during the events while you're doing sort of more story related type of things. But and when you do that, you have basically the option to cheat. Like you can take the enemy's health bar all the way down to zero, you can take your character's health bar all the way to full, you can like steal whatever buffs they have and take whatever debuffs you have on your team and move them over to the other team, and you can do all kinds of trickery like that. But you have to be careful about doing that, because every time you do that, your essence meter drops down a little bit, and you only have so much. So you have this like pool of essence, I think is what they call it. And if that gets down to zero, then you fail and you have to start over again. So you can use that to your advantage, but you have to be careful about how much you're using it. And your characters don't really die if they get down to like zero health and an enemy attacks them again. It just drains your essence pool. So even if like Dracula gets knocked down to zero health, if you have a big enough pool of essence, which you can build up along the way if you pick the right paths, you can avoid failing that combat if the enemy's attacks don't knock out all of your essence. But in my experience, usually if they get you down to that point, it's more than likely that you're done. Your run is done at that point. But yeah, I don't know. I'm enjoying it. I like the art style of it. It's kind of got a nice cartoonish art style to it, and the attack.
A good October game.
It is. It's excellent for this time of year. I recommend this game if you like turn-based RPGs, or if you played like Slay the Spire or Star Renegades. If you like that kind of a like turn-based combat game, I recommend it. It's a lot of fun. It is perfect for this time of year, like you said. Or you could just play Metroid Dread, I guess. That's another fairly solid like choice for this time of year. But
well, I teased this to you before we started recording, Zach, but I actually did prepare something for Aaron's parting wisdom this week.
Well, hit me with it.
I watch a lot of TikToks because I am a cool youth, Zach.
Hello, fellow youths.
Yes. But this is unrelated to that. This is just a TikTok that I saw, but it illustrates something that is very interesting to me, only available for one day. But go ahead and take a look at this, and let me know your thoughts.
I'm clicking on it now. The Curder Burger. So
it is a burger from Culver's that has a giant cheese curd on it.
We actually... So I don't know how inside baseball we want to get, but they... We had this on a local newscast.
Really?
Yes. We were talking about this. This is Culver's. It was for National Cheese Curd Day. It was one day only.
Yes. And I missed it. Or I just didn't go get it because I didn't want to spend money on it.
And I remember seeing even national articles about this. I don't know why this was such a big deal, but this started out as an April Fool's joke.
And did it really?
And then Culver's decided to make it a real thing. And so for one day only, you could get a cheeseburger that had like a giant, like...
A patty-sized...
Yeah, hamburger patty-sized cheese curd.
What is your reaction to this?
This seems like a heart attack waiting to happen, but... I guess it's not the most unhealthy thing that a fast food chain has made, probably, but it's probably fairly close.
I love stuff like this, not necessarily eating it, but I love fast food innovation like this, where it's just like, oh, we're gonna make a cheeseburger where the buns are fried chicken or something like that. I love to see it. I just thought this was very interesting, and it's kind of like a little slice of home, because I live right by Culver's, but I also, the first time I ever had Culver's was where we used to live, and I thought it was interesting.
When I was in high school, I worked at a Culver's.
I know. You used to work at Culver's. So what do you think about this? Would you have enjoyed making this?
Probably. I mean, this is not the kind of thing that they ever did when I was working there. So this is like maybe them trying to like get out on social media and be like more fun fast food chain. Because I feel like that like Taco Bell has almost owned the monopoly.
They cornered the market on
that. So Culver's is maybe trying to get in that game. But if this sounds good to you, you should mark that day on your calendar.
And you think they're going to do it again next year?
I would almost bet that this will be back next year.
Now, I have one time I did this thing where at Buffalo Wild Wings, they have basically this, but not, like a less exaggerated version. They have a cheese curd burger where... They just make a burger and they put like five or six cheese curds on it.
Yeah,
but it's not one giant one.
I was going to say, you could do this yourself by just ordering a side of cheese curds. But
also true. Yeah, super good. That's true.
But if you want the giant cheese curd, I almost think they should sell that as well. It's like a big old cheese curd.
I think so, man. Just like straight up just eat the curd. I think that's a good idea.
Yeah, I mean, so you know how for breakfast they have like hash browns, and like some places, I think McDonald's just has, instead of like a package of like small hash browns, they have like one giant hash brown that you eat. Mm-hmm. They could pretty much do that with this.
That's a good idea. That's a super good idea, Zach. We should be in charge of this stuff.
They should definitely consult us, and we'll let them know the best ways they can proceed with this.
But definitely, if you're interested in cheese curds, just search around. I tried to find a good concise YouTube video of this, but they're all like 5 minutes long, and it's just like some guy talking about like, well, now I'm ordering it, and let's take a look at it, and this is what I think.
Oh, do you
think this is just a nice concise like 5 second loop of what it looks like?
Do you think what's his name, Reviewbra, did he eat this?
Unfortunately, he did not. No. He doesn't have access to Culver's where he's at. He's in Florida.
Ah, okay. For those that don't know, you should just YouTube Review Bra.
Report of the Week is his name.
Yeah, Report of the Week. And
but if you search for Review Bra, you'll find a bunch of really good compilations of him. He's like a very fancy boy who reviews fast food.
He's a quirky individual who likes to go around getting fast food and reviewing it on his YouTube channel, and it's pretty entertaining.
I'm a subscriber. I will check in with him whenever Taco Bell has a new item to see what he thinks. He's very good at illustrating points, and his videos do sometimes get a little long because he does a little bit of comedy, but that's fine. I usually just skip ahead to when he's eating it and then talking about it.
He is not one for editing, I will say that much.
No, he doesn't really do a ton of editing. He basically just sets his phone up and goes. And sometimes he's like interrupted, and he'll just like, you can see him pressing the stop button and pressing the start button. But yeah, I don't think he really like has editing software. But that's fine. That's I'm not here for fancy edits. I'm just here for information.
Right. So yeah, check that out. I guess that's our recommendation for the week. But
yeah, a great YouTube channel, The Report of the Week.
So go ahead and follow us on YouTube at Starside Cafe. Just search for us on there. Our podcast should be up on just about every service. We use Anchor these days to get it posted. You can go to starsidecafe.com. That's where pretty much everything ends up going up in one spot if you're looking for multiple things that we do. And follow us on Twitter at Starside Cafe. And we'll catch you on the next one.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.